Hi, and welcome to the Academy Podcast. My name is Austin Parenti.
My name is Aaron Mejias, and we figured before beginning our series on Plato's Republic that we would do an episode talking about Plato himself and the historical context in which the Republic was written. So, without further ado, let's begin. Now, not much is known about the early life of Plato. In fact, according to Alexander of Miletus, in Lives and Doctrines of Eminent Philosophers by Diogenes Laertius, Plato's real name was Aristocles. Most likely, the name of Plato either came from his gymnastics teacher because of his broad, muscular figure, or comes from others describing his wide forehead. Either way, the Greek word platus means wide or broad. He was born sometime between the years of 429 and 423 BCE in ancient Athens to a wealthy aristocratic family of Athenian citizens that possessed a lineage tracing back to famous Athenian politicians. So Plato grew up in circumstances that were very much unlike most Athenians, who were either residential aliens known as metics, who had the responsibility of taxation and military service but could not participate in the body politic and had restricted marriage and property rights, or slaves who were, well, slaves. So he was provided for, well-educated, and slated to have a career in Athenian politics. Ancient Athens at the time of Plato's birth was at the height of its power, both militarily and culturally, presiding over a far-flung alliance of Greek city-states known as the Delian League, which had become much less of an alliance but more of a network of tributary cities, since the treasury of the league was housed in Athens. Athens was by far the largest and wealthiest city-state in Greece at the time, and was certainly a cosmopolitan city that exported a great deal of cultural and economic influence in the ancient Greek world. They built grand temples to the gods, held lavish festivals, funded the arts, particularly that of the theater, sculpting, and poetry, and also did business all across the ancient Mediterranean basin. At the center of Athenian life, and perhaps its most distinctive feature, was its democracy, since ancient Athens is generally regarded as the founder of democracy, which may be an oversimplification, but they are the ones that come up with the term. Without getting too bogged down in all the fine details of how the Athenian democracy worked, for our purposes, we will just say that the primary governmental body was known as the Assembly, which consisted of all of the citizens of Athens who would, by majority vote, decide all political actions and could be chosen by lot to serve in the bolé, which maintained the daily functions of governance if your wealth exceeded the required threshold. The Assembly possessed ultimate political power and sovereignty. There is no distinction in government branches like in an American democracy. All officials, besides generals, treasurers, and the superintendent of the water supply, which were all elected, were chosen by lot. The Athenian citizenry was not one decided by class or property, but rather was hereditary. An Athenian citizen was a male, at the minimum age of 20, whose parents were native Athenians. In Plato's time, there were no class distinctions that determined citizenship. All Athenians that were citizens had the right to participate in the assembly. However, most lived far away from the city, so the number of citizens who regularly participated in the assembly varied. It is difficult for us to conceptualize how important the democracy was for Athens and how politics for the ancient Greek world was central to life, because the question of politics was the same as asking how to make good citizens. Success in one's personal life, and to extension the success of a family, was synonymous with political success and influence. But political clout in the democracy of Athens was determined by your rhetorical ability. The ability to give speeches that are capable of convincing others would be the measure of political acumen in the assembly and in the law courts. Because of this, young men like Plato would typically be educated by a group of people known as sophists. Now, sophist means wise one, and the sophists surely claimed to be wise. The sophists were usually men who came from other cities outside of Athens to be teachers educating young aristocratic students, much like Plato, in the art of rhetoric and argumentation. They claimed to be imparting knowledge, but rather their education was more akin to training how to be successful in the public arena. But on a deeper level, the sophists and the sophistic education are defined by philosophical skepticism, moral relativity, and a lack of any belief in concrete metaphysical principles such as truth and falsehood. However, Plato was not educated by these sophists. Instead, Plato was primarily influenced and educated by a man named Socrates. We have to talk about Socrates.
I agree.
Although he was certainly influenced by other men, especially by Pythagoras. Now, Socrates instead proposed a new kind of education in opposition to the Sophists. Now, not much is known about Socrates or his philosophical beliefs, since the only solid historical accounts we have of him are through two of his students, Plato and Xenophon, but mainly Plato. And these must be taken with a grain of salt due to a variety of discrepancies within their accounts. It is widely agreed that the early dialogues of Plato can be seen more as a historical account of Socrates, whereas later works, such as the Republic, are considered more the philosophy of Plato himself, and they're known as the middle dialogues. Historians call this lack of knowledge of Socrates the Socratic problem. We know that Socrates was a man who taught in Athens, that he was ugly, and that he was executed by drinking hemlock. Socrates primarily taught moral philosophy, railing against the corruption of the Sophists and critiquing the corruption of the Athenian democracy. He advocated for the use of reason as our highest faculty, that through the use of our reason, we could discover the practical applications of virtue, while also having a disciplined lifestyle that denied the pursuit of earthly pleasures in order to obtain happiness through a well-ordered soul. This is best demonstrated by a quote from John Cooper's writing on Socrates in the Routledge Encyclopedia of Philosophy, where he writes, "Foremost is his conviction that the virtues, him being Socrates, self-control, courage, justice, piety, wisdom, and related qualities of mind and soul, are essential if anyone is to lead a good and happy life. They are good in themselves for a human being, and they guarantee a happy life, eudaimonia, something that he thought all human beings always wanted, and wanted more than anything else. The virtues belong to the soul. They are the condition of a soul that has been properly cared for and brought to its best state. The soul is vastly more important for happiness than our health and strength of the body, or social and political power, wealth, and other external circumstances of life. The goods of the soul, and preeminently the virtues, are worth far more than any quantity of bodily or external goods." However, while Plato is growing up and becoming part of the entourage of young men that followed Socrates, Athens and her allies was embroiled in a long and brutal war against their rival Sparta and its allies from 431 to 404 BCE, known today as the Peloponnesian War. Unfortunately, we won't be going over the details of the war here, but for our purposes, it's important to point out that Athens, the birthplace of democracy, has a brief affair with oligarchy. So a massive spoiler alert, Athens loses to Sparta. And following their defeat, Sparta supported the installation of an oligarchy that would be friendly to them and instructed the Athenians to select 30 men to rule over them. This group is now known as the 30 Tyrants. This new oligarchy sought to reform Athens into a model of Sparta. And so, like any other group of tyrants, they began seizing property, revoking citizenship rights, and executing any opposition to their rule. Historians end up estimating over 1,500 people were killed, while simultaneously giving status and privilege to those who were loyal to their regime. Skipping over a fair bit of history once more, at this point, a man named Thucydides, who they should really make a TV series about, was originally an Athenian general who supported the Athenian democracy. He led the Athenian democratic exiles against the 30 tyrants in a series of battles and successfully deposed of them, thus bringing their short 8-month rule to an end and restoring the democracy in Athens in 403. In fact, if you want a great bit more detail on this, Professor Kagan from Yale University has a great series of lectures on YouTube for all this information if you're interested. Athens would later go on and fight another war against Sparta, known as the Corinthian War, from 395 to 387, which we will cover even more briefly than the previous war, fought no more than 10 years ago between the exact same people. The conclusion of the Corinthian War was at best indecisive. However, Athens did regain a lot of its former power, asserted its independence from Sparta, and reconstituted a loose military alliance known as the Athenian League. But despite these successes, Sparta remained militarily and perhaps even culturally predominant in Greece. Within this period of political upheaval, Socrates is brought under trial for corrupting the Athenian youth. He is found guilty by the jury and sentenced to execution by drinking hemlock. Following the execution of Socrates, Plato founded the Academy in 387 BCE to sponsor philosophical education in Athens and then produced the Republic around 380. Now, why is all this information important? Well, beyond providing a historical setting for our coverage of the Republic going forward, it also gives us valuable insight into how we should properly interpret the work itself. The Republic is, for the most part, about the creation of a fictional utopian city that is ruled by philosopher kings. So, the question inevitably becomes, is it a political work, about how a Greek polis should be governed. Plato would definitely be sympathetic towards an oligarchy. The Athenian democracy and its alliance failed to defeat Sparta, suffer from corruption and a lack of discipline, and had put Socrates to death. In addition, Plato was associated with aristocratic families that were politically conservative, with some being part of the 30 tyrants themselves. And even his own great uncle, his mother's cousin, Critias, was one of the 30. So perhaps the Republic is advocating for a Spartan-like government with a rigid social hierarchy and well-disciplined military. But is that true? Because at the same time, Plato witnessed the atrocities of the 30 and chose not to join politics like most of his cohorts, and instead followed the teachings of Socrates. Perhaps the main concern of the Republic is not the supposal of a certain form of government, but rather a metaphor used to present the nature of a well-ordered human soul, that the roles of each class within the rigid structure of this fictional Republic are representative of each part of the human soul that are disciplined, placed in right order, with well-educated philosophy and command of our lower faculties, represented by the peasant classes. Or perhaps it is somewhere in the middle between the two views. As a compromise, the Republic might be an exploration into the nature of justice and goodness, that it is a work in which the political propositions, although being made, come secondary to the moral lessons that are being taught. That is, if we want a good city, we must have a just and noble government. And in order to have a good government, we must have a moral and virtuous people who love goodness and truth. And in order to achieve such an end, there needs to be philosophical education. And now, at this point, we are moving into an awkward transition. Since there is no better place to put this, I thought it would be important to first list out our characters in this dialogue, much like the beginning of a play. It should be noted that the dialogue in the Republic obviously never occurred between Socrates and these characters, and rather they are simply stand-ins for particular views that Plato wants to present. However, Plato did intentionally pick certain figures from his lifetime to use them as fitting conduits for particular points of views to be debated. Now, whether or not the characters presented in this dialogue and others are historically accurate to their persons is a matter of historical debate, but what cannot be denied is the importance of understanding the historical figures themselves and why they are included in the dialogue the way that they are. It adds a great deal of depth to all of Plato's works to understand the personal story of the characters involved, as well as why they are there in the first place. If you're interested in this topic, I highly recommend The People of Plato by Deborah Nails as a book to give the individual stories for the characters in Plato's life and works. So first we have Socrates, who is of course our main character in the story. Then there is Glaucon and Adeimantus, who are actually Plato's two older brothers. Cephalus, who was a wealthy metic, the resident alien of Athens, that made his money through arms manufacturing. He is the father of Polemarchus, Lysias, and Euthydemus. Polemarchus himself in history was wealthy and a resident alien, since citizenship in Athens was primarily decided by birth, like his father, and an arms manufacturer. He was persecuted by the 30 tyrants and killed, actually. They prevented the holding of a funeral for him in his own household. And then you have the brothers of Polemarchus, who are Lysias and Euthydemus. Euthydemus here is presented as the son of Cephalus, but the name is more famous from the Platonic work that bears his namesake, in which Plato presents a Socratic dialogue between Socrates and Euthydemus and uses the character of Euthydemus to represent passion and sophistic education to contrast against the new education of Socrates. Lysias, who was actually the brother of Polemarchus, also inherited the wealth and shield factory of his father Cephalus, alongside his brother. Lysias has an interesting bit of history that deserves special attention, but here, for the sake of brevity, we will say he was a famous orator in Athens. He denounced the rule of the 30 tyrants and supported the democratic cause through providing arms, money, and making speeches against the tyrants in support of democracy. He actually ended up escaping the persecution, and a handful of his speeches still survive today. Then there is Thrasymachus. Now, a lot of ink has been spilled on this guy, even though he only is the main responder to Socrates in Book 1 of the Republic. There are a lot of competing interpretations of what exactly is meant by including this character and his dialogue, but not much is known about Thrasymachus as a historical figure. We do know he is from Chalcedon, which was a city that Sparta and Athens competed over, and that he became a famous orator and sophist during the time of Socrates in the late 5th century BCE. On the surface level, Thrasymachus appears to be, at least, a character that conflicts with Socrates and represents sophistry in this work. So as we begin this series, please keep in mind all of the historical knowledge that we have given you in this episode, as well as the competing interpretations as we explore the text. We really hope that you enjoyed this episode of the Academy, and join us next week as we begin exploring the Republic by Plato. Please be sure to subscribe to our podcast on whatever platforms you're listening in on. Leave us a good rating if you don't mind. And if you'd like to provide some feedback or just give us a compliment, you can email us directly at theacademypodcast@outlook.com. We are always open to your suggestions and ideas, as well as some encouraging words from our listeners. Thank you, and have a great week.
Thank you.